Greetings. Since this is library, I thought I'd depart. This is dangerous in departing for my prepared program, but I wanted to mention a couple of books. This is in the library. It's our local field guide. This is actually the best local field guide on butterflies probably that's ever been written anywhere in the world. So if you want to learn about your local butterflies, great field guide. Field Guide to the Butterflies in the San Francisco Bay and Sacramento Valley region by Arthur Shapiro. And I'm indebted to Arthur personally for a lot of the information he had. And I wanted to mention this book because in the last 100 years of North American lepidopterology, this is the most significant book to come along. It's called Life Histories of Cascadia Butterflies. And what these two fellows did, one of them's a university professor, they raised from eggs, photographically documented and carefully described everything, raised from eggs, every species of butterfly native to Oregon and Washington, which has about a 90% overlap to the butterflies here. Probably about 10% of our butterflies here don't make it up as high as Oregon. But so there's a lot of valuable info for all the common butterflies, like, you know, most of the ones I'm going to talk about tonight. Certainly like the Anna's swallowtail and the buckeye and the red admiral and so on and so forth. They're all in here. And it's a real treasure trove of information for anybody that wants to get deeper into life histories. Certainly one of the possibilities for butterflies now is people, and it's a possibility especially for the native garden, people rearing them, letting them go. I've got at least one client that does that all the time. So anyway, to attract butterflies, there must be butterflies. And the problem we're getting is that there aren't butterflies anymore. They've been reduced in population very considerably. You've heard quite a bit about the monarch. And the monarch is in serious decline, and has been proven to be in serious decline. But there's about 14 other species native to Santa Clara County that are in severe decline. So they've actually declined more than the monarch, but they haven't been noticed too much. And so actually tonight, I'm going to say very little about the monarch, because there's lots of other people talking about the monarch. This is what we want for the monarch. Is monarch laying eggs on narrowleaf milkweed in your garden. And narrowleaf milkweed is a locally native plant of great value to butterflies. What's really kind of interesting about a lot of the host plants are the caterpillar plants. And this is the only locally native plant that the monarch caterpillar eats, this and this alone. But there are a few dozen other species of butterflies in all butterfly families that visit the flowers of the milkweed for nectar. So that's one advantage of planting this plant, and the milkweed is illustrative of the problem that we have with many of the plants for many of the butterflies and why the butterflies are in trouble, especially as regards to their native hosts. The native hosts of many of our butterflies are now extremely rare, even in our preserves. And many of them have never been cultivated. And many others are barely cultivated. And the narrowleaf milkweed is a good example that kind of a plant. It's not showy enough to have attracted the attention of most horticulturalists. For most horticulturalists, it's kind of a milfoil plant. You know, it's just not pretty enough. And it's invasive. And it goes completely dormant part of the year. But if you love monarch butterflies, and maybe you're not a hoity-toity gardener person. You know, I mean, it takes all kinds to make a world, right? Let it go in your backyard. Let there be a big patch of it. It's really very interesting. It's easy to take care of.
Yeah, right.
That's one thing about a lot of these plants. They have that. Up to a dozen species of butterflies have been seen in one large bumblebee plant at one time. Let's see if I can figure out. Okay. And this is an example, a western tiger swallowtail. This is our largest, showiest, locally native butterfly in Cupertino. Coming to the milkweed flowers. Coming to the milkweed flowers. Now, this butterfly is not in trouble. It eats street treats. It eats ashes, and it eats sycamores, it eats plane trees, native and non-native. In fact, a population has been discovered in Sacramento that eats liquid amber trees, which are not native, but are very, very common in our cities. And so, and this actually is the main reason that a lot of butterflies persisted until recently, was that a lot of them are eating weeds. But now the problem that we're having here in Cupertino and throughout the developed areas of this county is what we call gentrification. And so we don't have the vacant lots that we had. You know, when I first came to Cupertino in 1954, it was mostly vacant lots. And there were a lot more weeds, and some of the weeds are in the proper plant families for these butterflies. Some of the more adaptable butterflies to their caterpillars to eat the weeds. But now the weeds are gone. Now, there are some butterfly gardeners that are actually deliberately cultivating the weeds, which is actually a viable strategy for creating butterflies, although it has other, you know, has other problems. Not something I can really advocate here at the Native Plant Society. So, I'm here about native plants for butterflies. And the interesting thing about native plants for butterflies compared to weeds is that it's important to understand that every native plant has a whole host of insects that use it. In fact, a study of San Bruno Mountain showed that even every major herbaceous plant, like for example the mugwort or the coyote mint and things like that, every one of them had 10, 15, 20 micro Lepidoptera alone, just small moths that ate. And then, you know, a whole host of other insects and other orders, whereas a lot of our exotic plants that come from elsewhere in the world, some of them can support a pretty fair number of insects, but most of them support a very narrow spectrum of insects, very few species, maybe in good numbers, maybe not. And in fact, most of the plants that have become very popular in general horticulture that actually make the built landscape that you see in the valley here were deliberately chosen as being of no interest to insects. Mm-hmm. So that we have almost an insect-free zone to live in, which is desirable to a lot of people, but not to all of us. Takes all kinds to make a world, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. So everybody wants blue butterflies in their garden. And this is the Hackman blue. It's a species that is it's not in trouble relative to the study, but mostly it usually does not penetrate into suburbia or urban areas very much, mostly simply because the host plants are not available, the things that the caterpillars eat, which is, like I say, that's the main limiting factor that we can do something about. There's a lot of limiting factors on our butterflies, but the one that we can do something about is the plant, forage plant for the caterpillars. And that's why, of course, we're hearing a lot about planting milkweed for the monarch, because that's what we need if we want to keep the population up. In the case of the monarch, what people desire to do is to keep the population up sufficiently to retain the phenomenon of the migration. And that's the challenge. Some years we've really, you know, the population has been very close to very low. So anyway, here's the Akron Blue, which is a locally native butterfly that eats buckwheats and things in the pea family, and is visiting a California buttercup there. Okay. Now this is another shot of an Akron Blue, and it's on one of our native annuals, which is called Spanish Lotus. And Spanish Lotus is the most useful plant in the valley grassland for butterflies. It supports the caterpillars of 8 different species of butterflies, and it's a nectar plant for about 12 or 13 of them. And only recently has the seed of it been available. So it's just beginning to be available for people to grow. I have one client that we've got a big patch growing in the yard. Once you get it started, it maintains itself. A lot of these plants are, if anything, too easy to grow for a lot of gardeners. But at least the thing about this one is it will attract a lot of butterflies. And it actually produce butterflies, which is what we really need, because, as I say, there are very few to attract, and we need to produce butterflies. And so that's what I'm trying to get at with this talk and with a lot of the work that we're doing here with the chapter. We're about to create a lot of online resources that will go into a lot more depth. This talk will be just an introduction. Here it is on another one of its hosts, the deer weed. And of course, you know, both of these plants, the Spanish clover and the deer weed, they're not quite showy enough for people to grow them in competition with cherry picking the planet, you know, for a few showy plants you can get at Home Depot. But again, this is a plant of tremendous value to butterflies, more so in Southern California than here. Some couple of guys actually did an experiment with this particular plant because it's such a good caterpillar plant. They attempted to grow every species of California Lycaenid, which is the family that includes the hair streaks, coppers, and blues. And this is a caterpillar plant, including species that don't even normally ever use the legume family or the pea family. And they succeeded. So it is interesting. Butterflies can, and moths too, they can eat a lot of foods that they don't usually eat. They're kind of picky, they're kind of unpredictable like people. And sometimes they change and they'll eat something else. And a lot of times there's a lot of regional cuisines where there's something to eat locally. And this is one reason why, in order to help the butterflies, one thing that would really be helpful, all the butterflies, not just the monarch, all the pollinators, citizen scientists. Because you can learn a lot in your own yard by experimentation and observation, because it's a lot easier to, you know, it's a lot easier to observe things that are right under your nose. And you just go out the back door. Now, this is a picture taken in a butterfly desert in East San Jose, a block or two from the home where I put in a native garden designed in part to appeal to butterflies. There was an entire hedge of butterfly bush in full bloom without a single insect or any other flowers. That is what a desert this neighborhood is. But I planted some of the butterfly host plants and nectar plants. And insects can find each other over great distance. They can find another individual a mile away. They can smell another individual a mile of males. They can smell females a mile away, you know. And like the big hawk moths that fly all night, they fly miles. And so they go to fragrant plants. And in fact, they've discovered that air pollution messes with their ability to smell the plants, and it may be a factor in mitigating against their existence. But anyway, I wanted to show you that. See how the abdomen on this Ackman Blue is bending down towards the plant, towards the flower there? Caterpillars eat buds and flowers and developing fruits of flower heads of buckwheats. And this is kind of an illustrative photograph because this particular buckwheat is not locally native, but it's used in quote-unquote native gardening. Well, a lot of the plants we commonly use in quote-unquote native gardens are actually native to far distant parts of California. This one is native to the islands down off the Southern California coast, but it's an excellent, you know, it's an excellent plant for the garden. The chemistry is right, and as you can see, this Ackman Blue is laying egg on, and it's probably succeeding reproducing on it because lately I'm seeing more Ackman Blues, and I'm seeing them in these gardens, and I'm seeing them on buckwheats. And this is not the only person who's taken a picture of the Ackman Blue ovipositing on this buckwheat. So it's a good example of, you know, situations marching on with the butterflies getting different. And the nice thing about the buckwheat, the locally native Ariaga nudum, the naked buckwheat, which is very similar except not as pretty as this, is a host plant for 9 species of butterflies. 9 species of butterflies, their caterpillars will eat it. As compared to most of the plants out there, none of the butterflies can eat any of them, you know. But 9 species of butterflies can eat the locally native naked buckwheat. And I've listed about 27 species of butterflies that come to the flower because they're very designed to appeal to butterflies. And some of the butterflies that eat the buckwheats, they practically never leave the buckwheat. I mean, it's a one-stop shop, you know. That's where they grow up as caterpillars, they meet, they mate, they lay their eggs, and caterpillars grow up, and some of the buckwheat butterflies are very much like that. Okay, let's see. So this is the other locally native blue. You can hardly see it. It's in the center of the picture. One little blue there. But this is our California buckeye tree. And the buckeye tree serves over 50 species of butterflies locally. And I've listed, and it probably serves, you know, any butterfly flying that's in bloom. Nectar, and it's a caterpillar forage plant for this blue. And I've actually seen colonies of this blue on a California buckeye tree growing as a street tree in San Francisco. And then back in June, I went to the Hallberg Butterfly Garden in Sebastopol, where there's some old buckeye trees around the house, and there was a colony of this blue on that buckeye tree. So the buckeye tree is its favorite host. It will actually eat, known to eat all across its range, it's known to eat 9 different plant families. But locally, you can find it most reliably, and the only place I've seen it is on the California buckeye tree. Also, the California buckeye tree is the only place where I personally have gotten much in the way of good looks at the California sister butterfly, which is a very beautiful kind of tropical looking butterfly that usually flies around high above your head. You need to look up to see it because it usually stays in the treetops. And it eats oaks, you know. And we talk about re-oaking the valley, but we've got a lot of old oaks in the valley and some younger ones, but one of the things that was deliberately taken out was the buckeye tree. Because it turns out, unfortunately, the buckeye tree, the nectar on it is toxic to the honeybee. And so, therefore, you know, the early settlers here, especially the early settlers who made all their money and all the orchards that used to be here in the Valley of Barcelona, destroyed California buckeye trees in the valley with extreme prejudice. So we've got the Elks, but we don't have the Buckeyes. And some of the butterflies that live on the oak trees and other butterflies in the whole neighborhood are the worst off for it. Now, I think that the real concern about the toxicity of the nectar was mostly came back in the day when, there wasn't much else. When the buckeye tree was in bloom, there wasn't much else. But now we have so many flowers in bloom. I used to work for a Native Revival Nursery when it existed in a backyard in Campbell. We had a beehive, and the bees flew right through a buckeye tree, in and out to the hive, to the rest of the neighborhood. I think that the buckeye tree is not necessarily their top choice. It's not really technically a bee flower. It's really more of a butterfly flower. It's designed for butterflies to come through. Now this butterfly is a common checker, the common or the variable checker spot. This one is at nectar on a toy on a bush. In the wildlands around here, this historically at least has been one of the most abundant butterflies. In fact, one naturalist I know of reported seeing 201 times on one California buckeye tree. They're very abundant. It's very abundant in the wild, but it's another one that is practically never seen in suburban or urban areas. And the reason is because its food plants are not grown. One of its food plants is depicted here. This is the California figwort, otherwise known as the bee plant. And the flowers are about the size of my little fingernail, and they're brick red. It's not terribly showy. It's a fairly good sized plant, but it's not an ugly plant. It's just a very modest plant. But both the variable checker spot and the common buckeye, commonly the caterpillars, eat this plant. And it's easy to grow. It's easy to grow, and this one at least is in cultivation to a certain amount. If it were more popular, I think we might see more of the variable checker spots in gardens. I've seen one in a butterfly garden once. And its other host, this is the other host for it, which is the bush monkey flower, which is very, very common in the hills around. It's pretty easy to grow, but a lot of the time, when it's hitting it, it's really nice, but there's a lot of the time when it's not hitting it. There's a lot of the time when it looks kind of ratty, needs attention, need to cut it back a lot. But so it's not as popular as some of the less troublesome native plants. But for the butterfly gardener, it's good to know that this is a very good caterpillar forage for the variable checker spot. Yeah, this is the bee plant with a bee approaching. Yeah. Okay, thank you. That's a thought. Okay. Yeah. Very good, thank you. Good tip from my technical expert here. Okay, here's another shot of the variable checker spot on the California Phacelia. California Phacelia is a pretty good nectar plant. All the Phacelias are pretty good nectar plants for pollinators, including butterflies. Here's the buckeye. This is what the buckeye looks like. Now the buckeye is the variable checker spot came out in severe decline, worse shape than the monarch, as did that blue butterfly I showed you on the buckeye. Again, severe decline, worse shape than the monarch. And the California sister that I mentioned, again, severe decline, worse shape than the monarch. All right, that's why I'm here trying to hype these plants. So the Buckeye is another one that's okay. The reason the Buckeye is okay up to now is that it eats English plantain. But it also eats a very wide variety of native plants, and possibly more readily and perhaps more healthily for the Buckeye. Now, this is an interesting show. It's not a very great picture, but this picture started something. This picture was taken by Kathy Biggs up in Sebastopol. She's a wildlife gardener who got real interested in dragonflies. She wrote the first guide to common dragonflies in California. But this was a water plant in her pond, is what we're looking at there. And that water plant is mare's tail, which is fairly commonly grown in ponds. It's a California native plant. And these caterpillars are common buckeye caterpillars. And it turns out that at the time that the discovery was made, the mare's tail was considered to be in its own family. Since then, we've done some chemistry on it, and now they've decided to put it and many other species in the plantain family, which isn't too surprising, which is the family that the buckeye pretty well focuses on, and to a great extent the variable checker spot focuses on. But this was a discovery made in a garden, and it was published. I brought it to the attention of Dr. Shapiro, and Dr. Shapiro and Kathy published it in a journal of Lepidoptera. And after that, subsequently, all kinds of pond gardeners came out of the woodwork and said, yeah, we've seen them in our pond. We thought it was known. But no, it's not known a lot of times. It's very hard to find out what the host plants are, and especially to find out what they are locally, but what they are anywhere is difficult to find out. It's not terribly difficult to find out, but it's not. Let me put it this way. Very few people are working on it. And it would be wonderful if we got a lot more citizen scientists working on it in their backyards, doing experimental plantings, and just watching the butterflies. I have this one client of mine who is her hobby. It's almost all she does. And so she watches the butterflies very closely in her garden. And she sees these, she watches them laying the egg, just like the other client who took the picture of the acne bloom on her rosy buckwheat. And it's amazing what you can learn right out your back door if you have a native garden. And if you're interested in insects, and you want to see interesting insects, different insects, rare insects, just create a garden that reflects the local natural areas. It has the same species, hopefully in higher concentration. I mean, and this is a big part of our problem, is a lot of our natural areas, the concentration of healthy native plant growth is reduced because there's an excessive amount of invasive species, and there's also just an excessive amount of growth, even of native species a lot of times, so that tree canopies are closed, and there are so many leaf plants that they're sucking all the water out of the ground. And so, like one thing that's changed since I came here to Cupertino in 1954, there are a lot more seeps and springs and ephemeral creeks. And, the water would stay in ephemeral creeks long enough for the tree frogs to completely develop. And now, partly because everywhere we have allowed too many trees to grow, and sometimes outsized non-native trees like eucalypti, which are like 5-6 times bigger than an oak tree, and are used in some parts of the world to suck up all the water in marshes. I mean, that's how effective they are at taking away the water. And so we're losing all the wetland, all the mesic, the somewhat moist habitat, which is really what butterflies and most insects need, and really most small creatures, and most vertebrates too. Once you no longer have any surface water in an area, it's much less desirable, even for vertebrate life, let alone insect life. That's interesting that this comes up here. Okay, well, I was about to talk about the West Coast Lake, which one of its favorite hosts locally is the alkalide mallow. Alkalide mallow is a deep-rooted rhizomatous perennial that grows a lot of times in lowland type situation. Often survives continual mowing or even disking. My sister in Redwood City, who lives a few blocks from El Camino Real, an older house, has it in the utility turf in the backyard, which is basically mowed weeds, and it's surviving. You know, I mean, this is actually how they recreated the prairies. You know, they found the prairies in the cemeteries, the old cemeteries where they were just mowing what used to be prairie, and the prairie plants were surviving the mowing because they were so tough. That's how they recreated the prairies in the Midwest. Anyway, the alkali mallow is a good example of a plant that's, you know, nobody ever thinks about cultivating. In fact, unfortunately, technically it's a noxious weed. I think it was probably declared a noxious weed about 1880 or something like that. I think nowadays it's not a threat that anybody worries about. Technically, in fact, the Douglas iris, anybody have canyon snow? The Douglas iris is also a noxious weed, technically, by the way. But anyway, the alkali mallow is a tremendous caterpillar forage plant. I mean, that's its main value. You know, it's kind of a nice, tiny little weed plant. Yeah, a lot of times you'll see a specimen about, you know, that wide, about yay tall. It does best probably in a slightly moist situation. Around Walnut Creek, sometimes I see it growing with the frog fruit, which is a low-growing lawn substitute thing. Anyway, this is still a pretty common butterfly again, probably because it was using the weedy and even ornamental plants in the mallow family. Although it does just locally or just recently, the last couple of years, it's disappeared. It was one of the things that my client Milpitas loved to rear all the time. And we haven't even seen one in her garden for a couple of years. It's just gone. It's probably mostly becoming a victim of gentrification again, because the mallow family is not particularly popular in horticulture, and the weedy mallows are finding less and less of a place to live. So, unfortunately, I don't have any photos of the West Coast Lady, which is one of the butterflies I wanted to talk about. The West Coast Lady, when I used to work in Cupertino at an industrial plant, which was right at the place where Cupertino, Sunnyvale, and Santa Clara come together on Homestead Road. And that was back in the 70s and the 80s. And at that time, the most common butterfly that I saw coming to my ornamental flowers at the industrial park was the West Coast Lady. And now the West Coast Lady is in the most severe decline of any of our butterflies. So it's one that needs help. This is yet another one that's in severe decline. This is a comma. You see the little comma on the hind wing there, the white comma on the lower hind wing there? We call this the sadder comma. The sadder comma is a butterfly that among our locally native plants, and in fact among all of our plants whatsoever, the only plant that's caterpillars will eat is the stinging nettle. Stinging Nip is the only plant that the caterpillars of this butterfly will eat. And it's also a very important caterpillar forage plant for a few other butterflies. It's probably the most important native plant. It's a caterpillar forage for the red admiral. And it's also an important caterpillar forage plant for the painted lady and a couple others. So the Milbert's tortoiseshell is another one that we use. The stinging nettle. Of course, the stinging nettle is very hard to accommodate. Though I understand that Winston Churchill planted some in his garden for the butterflies. For the butterflies. However, I haven't heard of any artificial garden plantings actually working to attract the butterflies at all. You have the plant material available when you start rearing. You can, you know, bring it into your captives. And some of these butterflies, and this one is one of them, is actually very easy to rear. So the thing with the stinging nettle is, it's a plant that we need to use more often, especially in wetland restoration, riparian restoration. That's a very appropriate use for it. And I think some of our butterflies, I think, are doing a little better now because we have been doing some mitigation planting, so we do have a little bit more continuity of their caterpillar plants along our stream. The big problem with our streams is that, especially with, like, say, the Guadalupe River as it goes through Uistac Natural Park in Santa Clara. Uistac Natural Park in Santa Clara has a big butterfly garden. But usually you don't see very many butterflies there until about May, maybe the end of May. Even though right over the levee is the river bottom that is full of natural vegetation that includes many caterpillar plants for butterflies. The trouble is the sides of the levee are kept bare of plants. And those plants at the bottom of the levee, in the wintertime, when the river becomes a drain for the entire valley, the water rises very, very high and completely covers them in fast-moving, turbid water. And apparently it kills all the overwintering butterflies. And so they don't get back down to Uistac until May, because they have to recolonize down the river every spring. This is kind of one of the prices we pay for that kind of management of our water. Here's the red admiral, which I was talking about. This is the other major stinging nettle feeder locally. Locally, stinging nettle is its prime native host plant. The only reason that it's at all common is because we have another plant in the same plant family that is a weed. It's a pretty common weed. It's pretty common, especially in wetlands, and often comes up in side yards and comes up in gardens. And some people who recognize it let it grow because they know the red admiral caterpillars will eat it. Yeah. This one is a nectar on nine bark, which is one of our many, we have many, many locally native plants that they don't reach the top tier horticultural desirability of being, among the best in the world. This is one of them. It's really very easy to grow. But it's not terribly popular. It's really a pretty nice plant, to be honest. I think a big problem with a lot of these plants is that people don't even know they exist. And this is true for a lot of our butterfly plants. Even naturalists don't even know a lot of the plants that are the native plants that butterflies use. Here's a picture of the red admiral on a stinging nettle plant. Now this is another nettle. We'll talk about opportunities for citizen scientists. This is an annual in the same family. It's called black hair nettle. And I really haven't dared to handle it so I don't know how nasty it is. But it's really kind of pretty, actually. It's kind of a pretty animal. And it used to be one of the most common plants in California. And it's still pretty common in undisturbed habitat. And I'm pretty sure that I'm pretty sure if you fed it to caterpillars of the red apple, that they would grow from it. And they might even be using it, and it hasn't been noted as a host plant because nobody even knows what it is. Because it's a nettle, and it only usually grows about this tall, you know, about a foot tall. And it has these little flowers that you have to look at under a microscope to see what flowers on it. So most people don't even recognize it. It's never been used in horticulture, restoration, or anything else. But I think it could be interesting to experiment with. This is the field crescent, yet another butterfly in severe decline, worse off than the monarch. This one is visiting what I call Pacific aster, widely sold as Aster chilensis, now known as Symphyotrichum chilensis. And it was fairly popular. I think it actually may be losing a little popularity because it's a little too enthusiastic about taking over the garden. But it's basically the major caterpillar forage plant for this particular butterfly. And in fact, if you see it in a garden, it's most likely to be seen on this plant. And I've seen it in one butterfly garden where it came to a small planting of this plant. And in fact, Dr. Shapiro has noted that this is the plant is kind of like a detector to figure out how far these things fly. Because he had the plant growing in his butterfly garden in Davis, and he figured it was 5 miles to the nearest native stand where the butterfly could have come from. So he figured the butterfly had to disperse at least 5 miles. And this is a good thing about, you know, some of the butterflies that we have a little bit more hope for. They're pretty good at dispersing across the landscape and finding what they need as they go. A lot of times, if you plant the right plant, eventually you'll see the insect that relates to that plant. I remember reading about, there's a certain moth, a very large, showy moth that rarely makes it to southern England, and somebody planted the plants in his garden for that, and after X number of years, it finally showed up. But I had another experience with one of my clients was crazy about the Sarah Orange Tip, which is one of our prettiest local butterflies. I did a very small focused planting in her front yard of two of his caterpillar plants and one of his favorite nectar plants, all three of them things that are rarely cultivated, namely American Wintercress and Milkmaids in the mustard family. Those are the caterpillar plants. And then a blue houndstone as the favorite nectar plant. And the next year, for the first time ever at this house, and she lived there since 1966, she got a picture of Sarah Orange Tip in her front yard, right next to that planting board. Okay, this is another butterfly in severe decline, and I'm happy to say that the study went to 35 years prior to 2011. And since 2011, this butterfly has bounced back and had some good years. This is the Lordwings Admiral. A very conspicuous butterfly, makes itself conspicuous. Often in riparian areas, because it's basically a willow here. It's the main host locally are willows. In fact, here's a specimen photograph on the arroyo willow, another plant that's not terribly sexy, but very important for butterflies. And it turns out that willows can actually grow on as little water, at least, as you might need to keep them on from turning brown. They don't necessarily have to be next to a stream. So I've got a couple of yards where people are growing willows. And just by having the willows there, in one yard where we planted this willow, she had longed to see western tiger swallowtail in her yard. And all the yard is devoted to butterfly garden planting. But she'd never seen western tiger swallowtail until we planted this willow in her yard. It's one of the host plants. So it's a little extra inducement. They're actually, there's so much nectar. You know, there's a lot of designers out there. They know what the butterfly, so-called butterfly plants are, the ones that provide the nectar. And the world is way full of them. You know, there's huge plantings of verbena and huge plantings of lantana and so on. Lots and lots of nectar, lots of gardens with butterfly bushes. And the trouble is, there's no caterpillar forage. And we have the caterpillar forage. That's where the females are going to go, and the females go, some of the males are going to. But you're more likely to attract butterflies in many cases in the situation we have now with caterpillar plants. In fact, there's a small butterfly garden, and I live in Walnut Creek. There's a small butterfly garden in the park. Probably the whole garden is about the size of a seating area here. And I've never seen a butterfly in that garden. It's all flowers for the butterflies, but there's no butterflies to come to the flowers. So there's no butterflies there. That's why we have no butterflies. You have a situation where you have a huge amount of flowers and a few butterflies, how are you going to see them? In fact, this is one of our problems for interpreting the resource use. Even Dr. Shapiro felt that chamise was not a nectar plant, but I got a bunch of photos of butterflies getting nectar on chamise. The trouble with chamise, it grows in these giant masses, you know, so that the few butterflies that might be using it are lost in the vastness of the excess of the resources available. Here's another shot of the Lorcan's Admiral on a cow parsnip, which is a really kind of a nice plant in the carrot family, which is another family that's way underrepresented in all our gardens, and including all of our native plant gardens. And almost all the members of the carrot family, except for the Sanibel tribe, are host plants for the Anna swallowtail. This is a secondary host plant for the Anna swallowtail. So sometimes you'll find Anna swallowtail caterpillars in it, but it has these beautiful flowers. And in fact, this is the only plant that I don't get out much, actually. I do a lot of research at the computer, but I actually get out in the wild too much. This is the only plant that I personally have seen the Lorcan's Admiral with nectar. So I think it may be a favorite for it. And it's one that, you know, that grows along the streams. In fact, I was very pleased when I suggested that we plant it along this reach of blackberry, in Blackberry Farm, when we did the creek there. I suggested we plant a few of these, and I'm very pleased with myself that I did that. Here's yet another of our butterflies that is in severe decline, again, worse shape than the monarch. I haven't personally seen one around here since I saw one about 2008 or 9 on the Stanford campus. This is a mourning cloak. In Europe, it also is found in Europe, it's called the Camberwell Beauty. And it's kind of basically a tree-eating species. And this particular one's on manure. It's more likely to come to rotting fruit or sap than it is to flowers. But it's basically a tree-eating species that, let's see. that is one of the trees that eats again is the arroyo willow. It eats the arroyo, it eats the willows and the cottonwood especially locally. Another species I don't have a picture of, but since the year time is the sylvan haircake, I don't have a picture of it. It's another, yet another willow here. It eats the sandbar willow. And the sandbar willow is an interesting case. It's kind of like, there's getting to be less and less sandbar willows all the time because their niche in life is a freshly disturbed riparian area, especially like you get when you have real flooding. But we have only controlled flooding, we don't have real flooding. And so it's kind of dropping out, but it's one that we still need to use, I think, in our mitigation planning, because it's of particular significance to some of the butterflies prefer it to the other willows, at least so far as we know. And this is, again, like I say, a big problem with what we really do know. As I mentioned, the western tiger swallowtail, among native hosts, willows and eats, his favorite actually is actually the favorite caterpillar forage plant is the western sycamore, which unfortunately is, pretty badly affected with a kind of a disfiguring disease, and so it's rarely planted, although it still remains, remnant specimens along our creeks. Some people actually provide, people really get into a deep hole, have large potted trees just to have the tree, just have that foliage there. And it turns out actually that this butterfly, strangely enough, will lay eggs like 5 feet off the ground.
What is the flower with this, with the tiger?
This flower, this is an interesting flower here. This is one that's just beginning to be cultivated, deserves to be cultivated much more. It's elk clover, or California spikenard, which is a magnificent perennial. It grows about this tall. And it's a beautiful plant. It's a kind of a mesic, generally mesic redwood forest plant, although in some cases it even comes down to 100 feet elevation under the cottonwoods. But it's a beautiful, magnificent perennial that a few growers, especially native plant growers, are offering. And here is the western tiger swallowtail coming to the California buckeye tree, which is its favorite nectar source. The larger butterflies, like nectar sources that are higher off the ground, because if they have to go close to the ground, they can't maneuver so well. And so they're more likely to get picked off by a bird. So they seem to be more comfortable on a higher nectar source. So a lot of the larger butterflies are very happy to go into the trees if the trees are providing something. One of the interesting things that I learned by planting a big leaf maple at my mother's house is that big leaf maple actually is a flowering tree. It attracts tons of bumblebees, and the flowers also attract a few butterflies, which is kind of interesting to me. Here's yet another butterfly in severe decline. This is the California wing. And it is a butterfly whose caterpillars eat native grasses. One of the grasses it eats is the valley wild rye, which is a rhizomatous species that make patches as big as this room. It's kind of tough to accommodate on suburban lawn, but we need to have more of it in our natural areas. It's kind of like a bottomland perennial, probably has roots that can go all the way down to a shallow water table. And so that's one of its known hosts. Another known host for it is the purple needle grass. It eats our state grass, a bunch grass. They probably eat other, almost certainly eat other grasses and very possibly sedges and maybe even rushes, but we don't know which ones. For a lot of the grass-eating butterflies, there are very few people who are into the butterflies who are also into the grasses. So the grasses that the butterflies are using go unrecognized. Another butterfly, let's see. Yet another butterfly that came out of severe decline is another grass beater. It's one of our skippers. It's the woodland skipper. The woodland skipper is the one that swarms over vinegar weed. This is vinegar weed. It's in the mint family. This is one that flowers in the late summer, and everything else is dry and brown. And this is like the lead butterfly, maybe the lead pollinator for vinegar weed. And a lot of times you'll see a bunch of them on a vinegar weed. If you're in fairly good habitat with a vinegar weed, and some of the native grasses are there. It would be nice to get, one of the things that amateur lepidopterists do sometimes if they get into rearing is they do, challenge tests. You get a bunch of caterpillars and you give them a bunch of different prospective hosts and you see how well they do on them, or whether they accept them or not. Most of the grass beaters will accept and are able to grow on almost anything. But when you get deeper into those kind of studies, you can usually find that certain species are our favorite, either for reasons we may not even understand, and certainly certain species may enable the caterpillars to grow faster and get bigger, which presumably is better. Well, maybe bigger is not always better. Here's another butterfly in severe decline, the large marble. I haven't seen it in recent years, but hardly anybody has seen it recently. And probably a major reason is the disappearance of its native host. It turns out that the large marble eats plants that are mostly forgotten. And probably, we're kind of speculating here, but Dr. Shapiro thinks, and I think he's probably right about this, that the large marble's favorite plant is what we call California mustard, which has had several name changes over the years. It used to be Thelipodium glaziophyllum, and then it became Galenia glaziophylla, and now it's Calanthus glaziophyllus. But through all those name changes, I have never seen it even try in horticulture. It's never, I've never seen a seed offered. Some of the other galenias that are a little, or that we're calling galenias, they're probably called calanthus now, that were a little showier, barely, got offered by one seed specialist I'm aware of. But it would really be good if we could somehow get growers interested in growing California mustard. All the plants in the mustard family, for the most part, are very easy to grow. The reason that the California mustard is now so rare, it's been muscled out by the more vigorous alien weeds. And part of the reason for our native plants losing out is that they're such good food for so many insects. And so they have to bear that burden, whereas the latest introductions that are really, especially in the early stages when an exotic plant comes in, the population often explodes. It just covers the landscape because nothing has adapted to eating it yet. One of the things I saw when I was monitoring the riparian site, what I was actually interested in at the time was what native plants can survive and withstand the poison hemlock, which is a non-native weed that can grow, you know, taller than that, make very thick stands. So I was walking around continually looking at stands of poison hemlock, and there was one stand that happened to be on a circuit that I made fairly often, and one lonely miner's lettuce plant came up. And it grew to about this tall. And then one day I came back and it was gone. It was probably the only edible thing there, and some animal ate it. And so that's what's happening with some of our native hosts, especially in the mustard family. This California mustard is a host, also a caterpillar plant for the Sarah orange tip and for the checkered white. The Sarah orange tip's in serious decline, like the monarch. The checkered white is in severe decline, worse than the monarch. And it's also a host plant for the western white. And sometimes on a single plant, you can find the caterpillars of a few different species of butterflies. Whereas the alien members of the family don't have this same disadvantage. They do get eaten too. I mean, and that's one reason some of these butterflies have survived, because they will eat the aliens, although they may not be, you know, quite as chemically syntactic for the butterflies. They apparently aren't, because where the natives are present, a lot of times you're completely devastated by the caterpillars. And the only reason that you want to grow it in your yard is because you're a caterpillar farmer. And it's the forage for the caterpillars. The other important host, one of the most important hosts for the white marble, is the, and for several other butterflies, is what we call tower mustard. And I think, I just looked it up in the Natural Resources database, I think there were two preserves in Santa Clara County where tower mustard has been reported from. I last saw one in Cupertino in about 1984, in Fremont Overlook. It was either there or by Boss Pond. But especially locally, it's a rare and endangered plant. It's more rare and endangered than a lot of the rare and endangered plants. But it's not state listed, you know? And it's so, and very few people even recognize either of these plants. They're so rare. But those are the native hosts for our native white butter. And I think, as I say, I believe they would be easy to grow, but nobody has done it. Nobody has done it. Now there's one host of the Sarah Orange Tip, and I think the Spring White.
I would help.
Called Lace Pod. Some of you who go on CMPS hikes might be
Fringe Pod.
Cognizant of Lace Pod. The lace pod is a much smaller statured member of the mustard family. It's an annual about this tall. And it has a modest kind of a novelty when it goes into fruit. The fruits are very decorative. It's a nice little plant. A small number of seeds are being offered by Seed Hunt. And that's the only one that I'm aware of that's being offered. Another one, let's see. Oh, this, by the way, this specimen is, I'm not sure what that flower is, but it might be white brodia, Tritelia hyacinthina. And it turns out that, the bulbs do not normally come in container plants, and nurseries drive a lot of landscaping. So we have a lot of native landscapes that, unlike wild landscapes, have no native bulbs. But it turns out that several of our native bulbs are excellent for butterfly naked plants. And so that's yet one more reason to grow them. This particular one is extremely easy to grow. It's in nature, it's kind of like some mesic, slightly moist situation. So it's very garden tolerant, very easy to grow. And it turns out it's very attractive to butterflies. Now here's a large marble doing the politically incorrect thing, drinking nectar from an Italian thistle, which is one of our worst non-native weeds.
Butterfly nectar.
One of the things, I've been doing a big study of butterfly nectar, and there's a lot of butterflies. I wouldn't, you wouldn't know from the photographs, especially, that I can find the butterflies, that they go to thistle tribe flowers. But practically all butterflies love thistle tribe flowers. And in fact, in Jasper Ridge, where they allow this to grow unrestrained, this is practically the only butterfly nectar plant, Italian thistle. In fact, this is a factor that I fear that we haven't taken into account sometimes when we do like a yellow star thistle eradication in a native meadow, where we've already lost a lot of our forbs. And we take out all the yellow star thistle, when in fact the yellow star thistle, I'm sorry to say, is a very important pollinator plant. And it's also a host plant for some of our thistle-eating butterflies. It's very secondary, it's not nearly as good as our native thistles, but our native thistles aren't there. They're just not there. They're extremely rare. They're extremely rare. This is another plant in the mustard family that's an excellent nectar plant and a pretty good host plant. There's about five different of the white butterflies, including the large marble and the Sarah orange tip, that use this as caterpillar forage. And then it turns out that in the entire mustard family, including all the weeds, Amontillado, this is the top nectar plant. And during the period that it's in flower, it's very attractive. Much of the rest of the year, not so much. Not so much, but great caterpillar forage.
What is this plant?
This is American Yellow Rocket. American Yellow Rocket, or American Winter Crest. And this is one that, I think has possibilities for cultivation. Here's the cabbage white, which also happens to use some of our native mustards, but probably more readily uses the non-native mustard. Its favorite food is kale. It also, I didn't really do much of an analysis on it, but even the cabbage white is in decline. When I was a kid, cabbage white was, yes, declining. When I was a kid, it was probably the second most common butterfly after the skippers. But again, with the loss of people doing, abandoning their gardens in the backyard, or just having a backyard that's full of weeds like we all did when I was a kid in Cupertino, that's all gone now as we gentrify and as we develop more and more power to kill weeds. And of course, we also cover more and more ground with the impermeable works of man. Okay, this is a not too sexy plant that is the only native host plant for the great copper, which, no surprise, in severe decline, worse off than the monarch. I don't even have a photograph of the great copper. This is also a good host plant for the purplish copper, which, let's see what's the status on the purplish copper. Anyway, purplish copper, I think, is at least declining. I've only seen purplish copper at the used to be a bird banding station on Coyote Creek at some end of the bay. It was kind of interesting. I worked there for a few years, and we barely detected the purplish copper on a 4th of July butterfly count. And then about 2 or 3 years later, one of the things I did when I was working there, we were studying what was going to be destroyed by the flood control work. And what was going to be destroyed there by the flood control work were the last 10 specimens, less than 10, I think it was 9, of common spikeweed, which is used to be extremely common all around the bay. And so there were 10 specimens. So when we did the mitigation planning, the next mitigation planning coming up, for the initial seed mix, I went out and collected seed of common spikeweed, but there were still large numbers of it, and put it in the seed mix, and it came up, and when it came into flower, lo and behold, there were many purplish coppers, nectary on those flowers, that we would never have detected otherwise by putting that particular, you know, host plant in, and then we sowed it around the bird, around the National Wildlife Refuge in Alviso, and it's persisted, and I've been out there, and it's one of the few plants where you see a lot of butterfly action.
What is this plant here?
This plant on the screen is a willow leaf dock, which is a native dock. It turns out that most of the docks you see along the streams are alien species, okay? It turns out that this native dock is very strongly preferred by the great copper to any of the alien docks. It's a conservative species. It sticks with what it has known for hundreds of years, which is the willow leaf dock. And the willow leaf dock is it's not hard to grow, but it's not terribly sexy. It's not offered too much. Some of the specialty nurseries offer it. And it actually, I think, is kind of graceful sometimes. Here's one of the butterflies I've been talking about, the Sarah Orange Tip. This is the one that showed up to the experimental front yard planting of its mustard family host plants. And here it is visiting some blue ticks. Blue ticks are one of its favorite nectar plants. Here's another shot. Now this is kind of an interesting shot. This one is nectaring on slender phlox, which is one of our native plants that has flowers that are about a quarter of an inch across. It's in the phlox family, and the leaves are, it's kind of nice foliage, and it was being offered when I was doing a lot of experimental wildflower plantings around the house I happened to be living in about 2005. And I grew it, it was easy to grow. And the thing of it is, you're most likely to notice this flower because the butterfly is on it. The butterfly is much larger than the flower, but it happens, this particular butterfly happens to like that particular plant, which is like, I call it grass of the earth, okay? It's one of the forbs, not really a showy wildflower, just a forb that was very common in historic native grassland. Right now, if you look at a vacant lot anywhere in the Bay Area, the cover is probably going to be 99% recently introduced weeds. Back in 1933, when Jepson was doing his second manual, on a vacant lot, about half the plants would be things like this. Native, maybe not showy, native quote-unquote weeds, you know. But over time, like I say, a big reason is because the native plants are being eaten by the animals more than the non-native plants. So somehow we need to make up for this, I think. If we want to, you know, we want to keep the, especially if we want to keep the native animals in any kind of numbers. Okay, so this is another shot of the Sarah Orange Tip. This one is on some hedge nettle. And this is one of its nectar plants and caterpillar forage plants, the milkmaids. Now, historically, like in the late 1800s, early 1900s, this was like one of the most common wildflowers in California. It was everywhere. In fact, if you go down to Gilroy in less disturbed areas, there's still a lot of milkmaids. But you know, a lot of the areas closer to quote unquote civilization have been too disturbed, and milkmaids are mostly gone. But they're easy to grow in the garden. They're kind of ephemeral, they're very delicate. You know, they're not super showy, but they're kind of interesting, and they're easy to grow. This is an umber skipper. I'm happy to say the umber skipper came out over the 35 years of the study in, came out in severe decline, worse shape than the monarch. But in recent years, since they closed the study in 2011, it's had several extremely good years. So I've been seeing umber skipper, and in fact, one of the places we're seeing it is in native gardens. And I think one reason the umber skipper is doing better is because, for example, a lot of people are putting in native red fescue lawn, and it eats native red fescue. A fair number of people, or at least a small number of people, are using the tufted hair grass, and it eats tufted hair grass. And a small number of people are using San Diego sedge, and the caterpillars eat San Diego sedge. So I think that, you know, that may be part of its recovery, another part of its recovery, and perhaps the biggest part of its recovery is that it eats their harder grass, which has also been going gangbusters. It's one of the recently introduced grassy weeds that can be a pretty serious problem. But to help us out a little bit, the caterpillars of this butterfly eat. There's another shot of the umber skipper. This one's on the Corythrogyne, that's what's that? The California sand aster is what I call it. Oh yeah, okay. So now we're down to the common sooty wing. There's yet another butterfly in severe decline, worse shape than the monarch. I don't have a photograph of it here, I don't think. Actually, I think I do have one that I don't have permission to show you. But it's a very small butterfly that's black with some little white spots on it. The whole butterfly is only about an inch across, usually hangs out close to the ground. And its native hosts are basically native pigweeds, Amaranthus species, and native Chenopodium species. And what we have in this photograph, the thing in the center of the photograph with the kind of the grayish colored leaves that are kind of frilly on the edges, that is California goosefoot, which it turns out is caterpillar forage for the common sooty wing and for the western pygmy blue. And it's a plant that I think it has green flowers, but it's sort of graceful. You know, it has the grace of a species plant. And again, it's one that has never been cultivated. It's just not showy enough to compete with California poppies. But for those that are interested in habitat gardens, great habitat plant. And it's actually, I believe, I'm not sure that there's no sure about it. I think they think it's a perennial. I've seen it locally at Rancho San Antonio Park under willows. I've also seen it down at Moss Beach under the plants right off the beach. Okay, this is the American Lady. Yeah, now the American Lady is in the same status as the monarch. It's in serious decline. This year, I haven't seen one. You can tell the American Lady because of the big eye spots in the hind wings. You can see very clearly here. This one is on, I believe it's less than pinnacles. So I'm not sure what flowers on that. If we're lucky, that flower would be the Creek Senecio, which is one of the interesting local plants that has been overlooked for horticulture, probably because it's just a little bit too loosey-goosey. But there was at least about 10 or 20 years, who knows, you get my age. Anyway, 10 or 20 years ago, it was growing down near the headquarters of the Santa Clara Water District along the river. It was one of the plants that thrives in a real floodplain, okay? The sandy floodplain that might flood once in a while, you know? And of course that habitat is gone, and the plant is mostly gone. And I'm not sure, I'm not sure where it may persist yet in the county. But at one time, this was a very common plant. And it turns out that this particular plant is pretty hot for the butterflies. They love it. In fact, this picture here, we have an American lady in the foreground. And in the background there, in the blurry, is a Mormon metal one from the same plant. Now, the American lady, for its host plants, it basically only eats the cuttlefish tribe. Rarely, secondarily, it might even eat arrow or mugwort. Some of them were eating mugwort on Brooks Island in San Francisco Bay. I have a friend of mine who has purple everlasting on his property in Santa Cruz Mountains, and caterpillars were all over. They loved it. And Pete Villot, who will be giving that excellent lecture on container gardening and native plants, he had it on cotton batting plant, which is a pseudomephalia, a native pseudomephalia in his nursery. It turns out the pseudomephaliums are probably the major host for this particular butterfly as far as the caterpillar. And they're also modestly good nectar plants for various other butterflies as well. Essentially, without the pseudomephaliums or other members of the cutweed tribe, you will not have this butterfly. That's just the way it is. And it's really taken a hit with the loss of habitat. This is a Western tiger swallowtail that appears to be on a wallflower, Franciscan wallflower. No, pardon me. This is not a Western tiger. This is a Hannah swallowtail. Yeah. Sorry. It doesn't have the tiger stripes. It has, black and kind of that bold black and yellow. It's not a Western. This is a Hannah swallowtail. The Hannah swallowtail also came out in serious decline. Same status as monarch. But I'm happy to report that it is responding to the few people that are growing its host plants. Its major native host plant locally is the Kellogg's Yampa. And it has come, in more than one case, it has come and laid eggs on Kellogg's Yampa that I planted in gardens. So it truly is a plant and they will come. In fact, I planted a couple, and it likes an isolated plant. It usually likes either an isolated plant or the edge of a larger plant. But isolated, top right in somewhere, works pretty well for this butterfly. I found it one time in a little 4-inch pot fennel plants in the nursery. Ooh. It essentially will eat everything in the carrot family. Except for the Santa Clara. And the carrot family is greatly, I think, underrepresented in our gardens generally and in our native gardens specifically. And it looks like I'm over time, so I guess I just have to stop.